We do research on disorders of consciousness. So I'll go back and forth between Chinese and English. Is that
sure? Of course. Of course.
So it used to be called vegetative state, and sometimes they would even call it permanent. So a 永久的植物人状态. And up until about 15 years ago, it was almost a death sentence.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, with modern neuroimaging techniques, it's possible to look inside the brain, and as I speak, I'll sort of introduce people to. So,
yeah, sure.
So, 特别是近十多年以来，有一些突破。 那其中一个是也发现，差不多 40% 是被误诊的。They're not really 植物状态,
mm-hmm.
So they actually do have 意识经验, mm-hmm. that they're aware. And among the people here, so I'm going to say Li Kai first, because 黄立凯医生，他是双河的神内的医生, he's a neurologist at Shuanghe Hospital, and he probably has assessed more, we now say unresponsive wakefulness patients, but each end of
the okay. UAPs.
They don't they don't respond.
Okay.
Yeah. And then Li Jia, she's the Yanzhou Julie, and she spends a lot of time taking care of and communicating
okay.
with the patients. Mm-hmm. And Yanting, who's closest to you, and Neil Duncan. Yanting is, he doesn't look like it, but he's an American, based on a stereotype.
Okay.
And Neil is from Scotland, and both are experts in brain imaging,
mm-hmm.
in particular the use of MRI.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things we do with patients is that we put them into MRIs and we try to see what's going inside.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Yanting, for example, he looks in particular at, there's one function for analyzing the blood flow
mm-hmm.
in the brain. And Neil tends to, one of his specialties is looking at the activity of neurotransmitters in the brain. So a way of communication, chemical communication between brain cells. And one of our simple messages is that we hope that people who have family members
mm-hmm.
or loved ones who suffer from vegetative state, maybe it was from brain trauma, Naoshang, maybe it was from Chue Yang, anoxia, maybe it was
mm-hmm.
from Zhongfeng stroke, and even with Xinguandu, with COVID, there are people who they have a prolonged period where they don't recover consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So the Bingying, the etiologies are many, many types that we hope people don't give up, and that they realize that many, by no means all, but many of the people who have been diagnosed as being vegetative, they're actually aware of what's
mm-hmm.
going on around them. One of the early motivations for doing this is that we realized that in the published data, it's about 40%左右被误诊.
Mm-hmm.
And then more recently, the last 2 or 3 years, it seems to be more in the neighborhood of 15%到20%被误诊. Now, one of the problems is if you're someone like Li Kai and you're a good, hardworking neurologist, and you have a patient like that, it's basically you could just 看他们的行为.
Mm-hmm.
So if they're able to track with their eyes, mm-hmm. if they're able to, if you ask them to take something, to do something, to perform something, and if they cannot respond, even though they are awake, so we now say unresponsive wakefulness syndrome, even though they 他清醒了,
mm-hmm.
but they cannot respond. So, 课本上的说法是，他没有察觉到外界，他也没有察觉到自己的存在.
Mm-hmm.
That's the, although it's hard to know exactly what that means. So, under 健保制度, so in the current national healthcare system, after about 30 days, they're ready to leave the hospital. And for the most part, the clinicians are limited in what they're able to do and what they're able to say. They don't see the responsiveness. The patient might have started in a coma, 昏迷状态, which is different. So in 昏迷状态, they don't open their eyes and they don't have a sleep-wake cycle. But then they spontaneously open their eyes and they go to sleep
mm-hmm.
and they wake up. But they wake up and they seem blank.
Mm-hmm.
In the more tragic cases, it's been maybe 十二岁、十三岁发生, maybe they're 12 or 13 years old, and after 3 or 4 years, they don't respond. But then 他慢慢的就开始醒来,
mm-hmm.
but the waking, 而且这边是包含意识,他有意识到外面, mm-hmm. but after time goes by, people don't pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
So they're like that for about 5 years. And their self-description is their body becomes a guanzai.
Mm-hmm.
They're sort of,
mm-hmm.
yeah, it's a,
mm-hmm.
they're trapped inside of a coffin.
Mm-hmm.
And so part of the reason so Neil and Yenting spend so much time on this is we're trying to find ways with imaging, brain imaging, to see what indicators might there be? So if you're a neurologist like Li Kai, and you say, okay, can you guys help me? Because
mm-hmm.
I look at the behavior, and I don't see anything that suggests to me that they are conscious.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see anything, so the family members, the parents, the loved ones, they come in and say, is she or is he still there?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very hard question to answer. Another question is there hope?
Mm-hmm.
Will they get better? And it's extremely hard to say. And that's why looking at these brain chemicals and looking at cerebral blood flow
mm-hmm.
and then other things that we're trying to find, trying to identify a means of helping the clinician to communicate to
mm-hmm.
The family, you know, what can you expect? What can
mm-hmm.
you hope? And one of the tragedies has been that, so we've looked at 89 patients so far, but throughout Taiwan, it's getting, it's more like 160 or 170. And so after 30 days, the worry is that you have more people who are like that young man who described himself as being in a coffin.
Mm-hmm.
So they leave the hospital and then maybe they go to a huli jiajiao and no one maliciously, no one is trying to harm them, but they're there and their caretakers are limited in what they can do and they just disappear. So even if they have the opportunity to recover, to wake up, it's unlikely that someone would notice that they're in the process of waking up. So one of the motivations for creating the Da Na Yu Yishi Yanjiu Zhongxin, and also we have a graduate institute too, is there's three. This is what I usually say.
Mm-hmm.
One is that if you take a poll of scientists and you ask them what's the list of the top five most important scientific questions, in almost every list, what's the nature of consciousness? What is it that we, how is it that human brains and human nervous systems create our experience of the world around us? The other one is the clinical one, but it's both a clinical and it's a scientific one, because unless there's scientific breakthroughs, the clinician is very limited in what they can do, trying to find ways to help these people, to save these people. And the third one is just that in being able to move around and see more patients like this, we're able to call more attention, we hope, to some of the individual cases. So for example, Li Jia and Li Kai, Tom and one of the patients we have, and Neil was looking at the brain recently. It's a young man. He was in an accident and the anterior regions of the brain are very severely damaged. And yet, partially because they pay so close attention to the patient, they've discovered that he is able to communicate by answering with his fingers.
Mm-hmm.
So be, be-er, for yes and no. So you are able to have some level of communication. So there's one category of patients, and I don't even know how to describe this patient, but there's one category, they're locked in. So that means their body has trapped them to a great extent, but many of them can do something like move their eyes
mm-hmm.
vertically up and down and communicate. We have a patient like that in Jilong who's able to do that. And then this patient in this particular case is able to use his fingers to communicate. Now, again, going back to the main worry is that there might be many more patients like that, but they can't use their eyes and they can't use their fingers. They're limited in many ways.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't know, maybe Li Kai could tell us, 你觉得有关这个病人，你觉得他的情况是？嗯，就是这个年轻人。那还是其他的，如果你觉得比较，对，就是。
大概就是这一阵子，因为我们接触到一些意识损伤的过程。那当然，因为我们神经科医师还有神经外科，大概常都遇到急性损伤。那不过急性损伤有时候他自己的病程改变，他的意识就会有恢复。但到了比较中后期的时候，其实比较难去判断，因为同样的影像或者同样的一些参数，但是看起来的意识的预后不太一样。对，那所以这个刚丹老师讲到这个病人，其实也是他在车祸之后就没有。互动的能力，但是可能在某个时间点，刚好我们接触到他，当时我们就发现他有一些可以跟我们做我们用语言的方式，让他可以做一些回应。那所以当时也是我们先看到，因为大概平常不太会有人去反复做这样的测试，对，所以还是可以看到，就算他的脑部其实还是很严重的损伤，但是还有一些改变在里面，对，所以我们这样一路遇到比较多的就是会问说到底有没有机会，然后还有。他的一些表现到底是不是他有意或无意的动作，那我们其实比较难去回答说他意识的程度或是他脑部现在跟外界行为的连结，所以可能会需要更多的测试或工具。
So Li Kai talking about the different techniques that they might need to help them make an appropriate diagnosis and also a prognosis. So what's the long term likelihood for this patient. So one of the things that Neil does is, do you want to, so there's a one particular neurotransmitter in the brain called GABA, and that's one of the things that Neil looks at. One of the functions of the MRI, it enables you to get some sense of how this particular chemical is acting in the brain. Neil, did you want to?
Sure. I think what I do is maybe illustrative of how we're working at the interface between clinical research and scientific research. Because I'm a scientist, I'm not a clinician, and I'm interested in scientific questions that hopefully ultimately help clinical people to do their jobs, but maybe that's 20, 30 years down the line. So yeah, I look at neurotransmitters in the brain, where thanks to technology, we can now do this. Try and do it now. So GABA is one of the key transmitters that helps organize the way neurons communicate with each other. So if we think of consciousness as information transfer and information integration in the brain, then the logic being then, okay, maybe this transmitter is a key player in that process. So we've been doing some work with that with some of the patients that we had at Shuanghe Hospital, is where we've done this research. Well, the patients come from all over Taiwan. And there's some interesting early indications that yes, this system is altered in people who either have no evidence of consciousness or have extremely limited consciousness. So just borderline flickers of consciousness. So I think that this is hopefully a promising line of research, because obviously if we understand where it comes from, then we can hopefully try and change it so that we can raise levels of consciousness or restore levels of consciousness. But as I say, that's not going to be next year or 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 10 years. Fingers crossed. Fingers crossed. Do you have anything you'd like to know about that?
Yeah, sure. So you're trying to establish certain patterns as a necessary, sufficient condition for consciousness?
I'll be happy with sufficient.
Ah, okay.
So the brain is very adaptive.
Mm-hmm.
So people talk about necessary conditions of consciousness, but mm-hmm. I mean, even when we look at people who say have their visual regions damaged, mm-hmm. then over time you find that another part of your brain suddenly is processing visual information.
That's right.
Because our evolution is quite clever.
Mm-hmm.
So
multi-purpose, general purpose.
That's it.
Yeah, neurons.
Within limits, and mm-hmm. so sufficient is fine. If we can get it working, that's okay. The necessary conditions for consciousness, you can have an interesting discussion about whether that
mm-hmm.
makes sense to ask that question, and whether mm-hmm. we are ever going to understand that.
Yeah, sure.
But as a
that there may be necessary condition of our language before we can talk about it.
yes, which it might be. Maybe it's the lions speaking that we don't understand.
Mm-hmm, sure.
But who knows? Mm-hmm. We'll leave that on to the philosophers for the moment.
So the point is more applied then. So like aiming to discover certain patterns that you can induce in the brain to wake up consciousness from other parts of the brain that aren't damaged. I mean, what was the kind of ideal state in things?
For me, understanding.
Uh-huh.
Once you understand things, then applications just become an engineering
sure.
question. So people would disagree with me perhaps, but I think if we understand it, the rest comes.
Okay.
I won't say easily, but obviously it's not easy, but then the steps to having an application are become obvious to you. Oh, this is how it works, do this. If you understand how your car works, then you can fix it.
Exactly.
Might not be easy,
mm-hmm.
And you know, getting the tools might be difficult or the spare parts, but
mm-hmm.
in principle, we can do that now. So
okay.
if we understand it, I'll be happy.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, that's more than what our field, the machine learning field, can ask for some days. Right?
Well,
we see that it works, but we don't know how it works.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of our clinical understandings are not so dissimilar from machine learning
mm-hmm.
stuff. Well, if we do this to the brain, it mm-hmm. does a different thing. Okay, let's keep doing that.
Okay.
Which is fine, because it helps people.
But you're interested in the actual mechanisms.
Yeah, getting inside the black box.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Thank you.
And Yenting works on, it's a particular technique of looking at how the cerebral blood flow, and these. I think he's begun to think about some machine learning applications as well, or am I leaping too forward into the future? Am I?
Yes, maybe, because...
Okay.
Yeah. May I speak in English
maybe.
Or Chinese?
Yeah, you can speak in JavaScript if you like.
Okay, maybe. Uh-huh.
Okay,
It's okay. So Li Kai is clinician. Mm-hmm. 照顾病人，那我是放射科医师，所以我是影像的，就是帮这些病人的脑去做影像。那这些病人的很大特色，植物人 vegetative status 或是 responsive wakefulness syndrome 这些病人，他的问题就是他不能帮他自己说话，不能反应这样子，所以没办法主观的去让医师去评估，比较困难。那所以我们放射科的特点就是我们可以客观的用一些影像来帮病人做评估。 那，例如说呢，在大脑来讲，大脑是一个很特别的器官，它很贪婪，就是说它只有5%的质量，但是它却占了20%的脑的血流这样子。对，那所以那这些血流主要就是提供脑的这些神经元去的能量去提供，所以那个 cerebral blood flow 是就是提供这些神经工作一个很重要的来源，所以我们大家也可以去看说这些 blood flow 在脑里面的高低。 来碰到这个人的情况，所以很多研究就显示说呢，这个不同的 conscious state 的它的 cerebral blood flow 的情况会随着它的正常的脑 或是 minimal consciousness， 或者是 vegetative states 会下降。那这个下降不只是全脑性的，它也是跟区域有关的。例如说，有些人就发现说，在一些跟外界沟通相关的，visual area、auditory area， 或者是一些比较跟 attention 跟外界互动相关的这些脑区的这个 cerebral bulk flow 会下降。那这个下降严重度会随着他的抗血症的不同的变化。那这个脑事实上在哪些脑的区域里面是真的有意义的，这个也是很复杂。所以也有些人开始就是我不可能说，我就只看这个点脑龄的这个区域有没有下降就去判定它是不是植物人啊等等的。所以呢，现在也有更多的科学家开始试着使用例如说 machine learning 的方式。因为这个我们machine learning 就是一个 data driven， 不是 hypothesis driven。我们不一定确知说哪些区域就一定是会造成这些问题，所以用 machine learning 方式去看说，这个脑里面的问题是怎么样，那可不可以做区分出这个不同的 status？ 那目前也发现说，用 machine learning 的方式事实上会更有效，结果会更好这样子。对，因为这些都是 data driven， 所以会需要有更多的病人、更广泛的世界去做测试，才能够证明它的 generalizability。那我们的话很特别的，用测量那个 cerebral blood flow 的方式是通常看血流，因为血流就是 会流动嘛，我们通常要打显影剂，那显影剂就会有一些可能的一些 concern 这样子。对，那我们是用一些比较在 MRI 里面，我们用一些比较新的技术，它是可以标记那个水分子，那在血里面的水分子被标记之后流到脑里面去，我们就可以看到它的那个血流的情况去评估。那这个是不需要打显影剂的一个技术，这样子。那我们是在这方面就是蛮成熟的。那也有跟国外的那个机构，像 Stanford 大学合作这些东西，这样子。对，所以 it's my
field. I'm probably gonna say something that Yanting and Neil will pull me back on right away, but I'd say one of my hopes, I'll express it that way so it's less easy for them to criticize what I say, would be that someone like Li Kai, so if he has a patient in the hospital, that if these techniques become mature enough, that Neil could say, okay, Li Kai, we're going to put this patient in the scanner, or we're going to look at the concentration of this neurotransmitter in one part of the brain,and provide you with that information to help you make your diagnosis, or if it's cerebral blood flow, same thing. So if that takes 5 minutes or 6 minutes, and I realize this is a practical question too, in addition to the difficult scientific and clinical issues, would there be some way perhaps that like Jin Baoji, National Health Insurance, could cover something like this in order to protect patients of this type?So that we have some reason to believe when the day comes, when it's mature enough, that they can help Li Kai in this way, and that also then Li Kai can then better help the patients and the family of the patients. So that's, have I run too far into the future? And feel free to correct me.
You didn't specify a date, so.
Hopes aren't endless.
I think that's not unreasonable.Because we're always just producing tools to help physicians make decisions. So with all of these technical tools and all of these, as we went to machine learning based aspects to those tools, they're always just there to help people make decisions. So sure, we can hopefully produce a tool that says, okay,there's a 60% chance if this patient had this etiology and they show these behaviors and they have these additional things, then this additional test will suggest something for the future. So that sounds less hopeful, but I think that's a realistic outcome in the near future.
I'll take near as meaning within 10 years.
Yeah.
Okay, by 2030.
Okay, it's on video, so. I'm held to it. That's me held to it.
Hold it, future is nice.
we're trying to find some simpler ways, which are less burdensome, less cost expensive, and also for many patients, if they have a shunt, then you cannot put them in the MRI. They have metal implants. And so even sometimes things like you take a foul smelling odor and their ability to sniff or just ignore it completely. There's simpler things like this, and then also the circadian rhythms, the cycle. And that one patient that we have in Geelong, for example, she seems to emerge into an locked-in state, but it's always late at night, and then it dissipates rather quickly. Or the patient in the hospital now, he seems to be able to sustain communication for maybe 5 or 6 minutes, but then also fades away. So we're trying to look at other things which maybe can be measured by body temperature or by heart rhythms, or even just something like whether or not you sniff. And in addition to this, there are some extensions. For example, there's a number of phenomena related to consciousness, like one is called blind sight, mamshir. So it would be, I think, inappropriate to mention the name, but there's a patient that some of our group in BCRC, Dana Yishi and Zhongxian, have been looking at. And it's just a phenomena that if you put the patient in the hospital, they subjectively feel like they are blind, and they say that they cannot see anything. But if you put obstacles in their way, they can follow a path and maneuver in such a way as to avoid. So they are visually processing information from the world, but they're not visually processing information from the world in a way in which they're consciously aware that they're doing it. But you can put them in a situation, like there's one, a young man who was an athlete, and he's still able to hit balls and things. There's many fine subdivisions. For example, if something is moving, there is the opportunity to respond, even though the person would persist in saying, I don't consciously experience that. So there's a part of me which is, I'd agree with Neil, I'd be satisfied with the sufficiency, but there might be some necessary requirements in there. But I wouldn't dare to try to state what those necessary requirements are. So, and in addition to these things, we're trying to expand. So there's only a few of us here today, but we've tried to make the center, you know, because I'm the old guy, I'm 68, and this is probably my last hurrah. This is the final event or activity that I'll try to devote myself to in this lifetime. So you try to hire people who are younger and smarter, and they can see the future better than you can. So if I were to project into the future, I would say the problem of consciousness is going to be ever more important. But I don't know that for sure. So some of our scientists and clinicians, they work on bipolar disorder, and some work on, and Neil's done a lot of work on major depressive disorder. And then there's a sleep and what other things are. Trying off the top of my head now, I'm sort of hesitating.
I mean, the list is quite long. Certainly sleep disorders. We've got people studying, even people who are studying the brain that then study things that you wouldn't expect to be related. So the interaction between the brain and kidneys is something that one of our colleagues does. All sorts of interactions between different organs in the body. Well, your brain is an organ in the body, so they all talk to each other. And that feeds into a lot of different disorders that follow on from from that kind of, again, finding out, well, no one knew that the kidneys and the brain talk to each other until our colleague discovered this. And that opens up all new questions that I know there's some neurological disorders that come from kidney dysfunction and so on, and maybe those kidney dysfunctions that come from neurological disorders. Well, I want to put the neurologist is looking somewhat skeptical. So yeah, we do all sorts.
We try a lot of things. We have people, we work with people, we work with other mammals, and we have one colleague who works with insects.
Mm-hmm.
I sometimes feel that what he's doing, if you go back 20 or 25 years ago and you look at all the psychological tests that were applied to undergraduate university students, he now takes them and he's applying them to spiders and cockroaches and things like that, and finding that their very limited nervous systems are capable of quite a lot of activity.
Mm-hmm.
But so it's a broad team.
Yeah.
And we tried from the very beginning to make it as open and as democratic and have people just follow their own path, because again, at 68, I'm not able to see the future as well as they're all 30 years younger than me at least.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's one of our hopes, one of our ambitions.
Just a fun finding, I think, I hope Christoph won't mind. Has he seen the person that works with the spiders has got early evidence that spiders recognize each other.
Mm-hmm.
So they seem to be able to tell, oh, that's John, that's Patricia. And so, you know, when we're squashing spiders, maybe the other spiders are, you know, going off and being, oh,
mm-hmm.
What happened to John? He got squashed. So, it's just up to him. I think that's a really fun finding that he's made or is working on.
One of the things I like about his work is, although one of my concerns is the application, so clinical,
mm-hmm.
can you actually do something to help people?
Mm-hmm.
But I sometimes worry that it gets overlooked that, I shouldn't say more than half, but a lot of the good mathematical work
mm-hmm.
was done without any sense that this was going to be applied in the way that it is now. And I think a lot of this, people who just have these keen interests, and in mathematics, it's often something like, this is more aesthetically pleasing,
mm-hmm.
or in mathematical logic, this is more aesthetically pleasing. Now you can go into that and specify what's pleasing about it, but I do sometimes worry that we lose this encouragement for people who are doing pure basic research that's just intrinsically interesting to them, and that they can come upon these findings, and it'll only be later.
Mm-hmm.
If we're able to communicate outside of our limited Earth environment,
mm-hmm.
it seems like the language of the universe would be mathematical.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's applying that to what we're trying to do, although I'm passionate about trying to find ways to help the people who, again, used to be called vegetative. But if the science is not done well, and a lot of the science being done well is it's driven by pure interest,
mm-hmm.
that's not necessarily in any way connected to
mm-hmm.
how can I apply it tomorrow or how can I apply it today.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any questions you would like to ask of us, or would you like
we haven't finished round of introductions.
I apologize for that. Jaz, I mentioned,
yes.
is our research assistant,
mm-hmm.
and works very closely with Li Kai,
mm-hmm.
on the patients. And Wan Qing, she does all the hard work of keeping the administration for our center together. So my apologies for looking.
And this is Meiqi, our Ministry of Health and Welfare Department, specializing in, I believe, health policy and designing of the long-term healthcare, among other things. Also contact tracer. So it helps a lot of our work with the Ministry of Health and Welfare, specifically to introduce emerging technologies. Because in the MOHW, there is a very long horizon planning going on. But I think the bi-directional communication, as Meiqi often says, with the academia and private sector and so on, the bandwidth is not always symmetrical, trying to put in a very politically correct way. so that's where Meiqi shines as a 2-times presidential hackathon champion, helps us to design better communication channels with the society.
I understand.
Yeah.
When you say the bandwidth with industry and academia is not
entirely symmetrical.
Which direction's the problem? Like, is, without putting yourself in hot water, I'm just curious, is there something that academics can do better to communicate things? Because this is something I'm kind of interested in terms of, you know, science communication and, and the role of scientists in society. So would you say academics are an issue and that we're bad at communicating, or is it other actors that are maybe not good at listening or asking the right questions?
It's okay if we speak Mandarin. We're all bilinguals here.
You're not.
Okay, I'll do the interpretation.
Apologies.
Okay,
虽然我觉得这个大脑意识研究的中心，我刚听的案例啊，好，还有就是我们很像是很努力的在找有一些个案的机会，好，然后希望能够有一些更帮忙的这样，即使介入帮忙那个个案，尤其是很就是年轻的个案，我觉得这个是真的是非常重要的事啊。那因为我觉得这样的个案如果能够及时发现，确实是后面的家庭跟照顾的社会的压力是可以减轻的，嘿，尤其是 young man 这种 brain damage 之后造成的一个家庭的这个压力是非常大的，嘿，还有个人部分。那先到这边
了。OK， 没关系，我这个平宽还蛮宽的，
疑惑的地方。
Yeah, sure, sure. Yeah. So, but to answer your question more directly from me first, before translating, so for example, we've been working on so-called privacy enhancing technologies (PETs) for quite some while. Many of you maybe have used it. It's called 简讯识别制的1922 QR code scanning stuff that people do on contact tracing. But the academia knows that there's a way to kind of maximize the usefulness of data and conserving the privacy for quite some time now. If you throw enough computation power at it, it's a solved problem, so to speak. But the industry doesn't necessarily know that. So the policymakers get a lot of lobbies, I'll just say it, from the industry that operates on the previously kind of zero-sum trade-off spectrum that academia already knows how to solve. And then academia gets the pressure because of funding priorities and so on to kind of reinforce the existing bias on the previous generation of industrial assumptions to research on things that are based on kind of previous era research assumptions. But actually, if the industry receives more information, the future is more distributed from academia, then everybody would be kind of operating outside of that local optimum and on a more coherent framework that sees privacy enhancing, if designed right, as something that actually improves data usability. And so that's just one very recent case that we're working on. Yeah, but that speaks about the symmetry. Now the translation. So Meiqi is saying that, of course, this work on the consciousness research, specifically on younger people and helping them, can actually have a lot of social effect, especially on alleviating the fears, anxiety, and concerns about family members, other community, and so on, and actually have a kind of rippling social effect because everybody feels more sure about this. And then...
完全就我完全都理解，可是我大概只想说我有一点一个疑问啊，好，就说我们这个研究中心我们想要找的是在治疗期对象，那 purpose 是譬如说在医院住院治疗期的，就是可能他是紧急受损啊或中风或者是那个 AVM 啊什么那些的，好，那段的个案，然后呢就是紧急治疗，还是说像譬如说有些人他会出院了，他譬如说不管去 nursing home 或者他复健他又回来搞不好感染啊什么，他是在恢复期，就是有些人他还是在复健，可是因为我知道那个脑部就是刚刚那医师讲脑部其实是一个很灵活又很变化很多的，你们的对象是在 这边的还是后面的，还是说什么 sign 就是让
应该算去各都 有,、
哦、但都有，
而且我们不能说治疗所以我们去执行一个临床实验，
对对对，
但是我们那当然立凯可以负责诊断，但是我们这个科学团队我们不能说诊断，我们也不能说治疗，我们去 repurpose 某一种药，一个安眠药叫做 Stilnox， 但是也有别的单位都在 repurpose， 所以第一我们不能这么说，所以还是研究的阶段
study
那我们去全台湾屏东金门都有的，有的是主动来找我们，有的是我们主动去找他们，有的是我们现在有一个团队就在主要是双和，但是万方北医附设台大新国民在桃园长庚的医生都会介绍病人到我们那边，而且确实我想如果立凯如果我讲错的话你会纠正我，可能他看到比较年轻那情况没有持续说超过五年，而且有几个因素嘛，那可能脑伤他有好转的机会比缺氧的稍微好一些，这些是有，但是我们也有遇到那些六十几岁的七十多岁的，其实他们的情况没有现在我要 be political be careful 可能没有原来想象的那么的糟糕，而且可能随时，我想这个立凯应该也会认同，任何人如果家里有这种病人还是朋友，你在旁边讲话要非常小心，因为我们不敢确定，但是确实有一部分的我们确这个是我们确定的个人我们就不敢说，但是确实有很多他后来有恢复，那他说哦，当时我只是有听到这些话，所以讲好听一些，讲正面一些，这些这个应该我这样子讲，立凯你觉得我有没有？
我觉得很赞同这个，对，就是说因为有时候其实就是比如说家属或是照顾者，他们观察到一些比较细微的现象，他们有时候会自己去解读，那有时候会觉得这是他的习惯，他跑出来有他的。个人的色彩，对，那不过对我们来讲，我们大家也是就是在观察他讲的是不是能够重现，那所以其实有一些状况他后来在反应上能够比较多的表达，会更多的就是譬如说他当时我们看起来没有反应，就也许他已经在内在有一些就是在听啊或是在思考这些动作，对，那我们其实收案就是并没有限定，但急性期有一些治疗标的，所以其实未必会在比如说研究或是他还在做他的主要治疗，不过通常都是治疗到一个阶段他们觉得说没有什么可以再治的时候会有这个问题，就是说那后来下一步要怎么办，
所以后来那些人变成他后面还需要继续跟他的主治医生就进一步的谈下去。所以
我不太懂你的那个对象了。
目前为止我们做完的有89个，所以那个是也做 MRI， 就是 Neil 跟燕婷的专长，还有做跟何一也有合作，那做 PET analysis 看脑的代谢，那还有这个我们给他们的药也看他们行为上的反应，所以这些都已经做了大概89个，那全台湾各地去评估，我忘了160几个、170几个，那许多是因为一些特殊情况，比如说金属，我们就没有办法使用。不过我们是希望范围能够扩大，所以包含全台湾，但是经常遇到一些很现实嘛，经费的问题。所以好比说，如果有一个病人在屏东，那他要从屏东坐救护车到双河，那就那个是现在大概多少？
3万。
3万。
嗯。
3万块。
交通费。
嗯。
救护车的
交通。救护车。
嗯。
所以就是。
他一定要到我们的 center 这边才可以参与吗？
才有那个机器吗？
对，就是他除了做这些，比如说 MRI 啊，或者 chemical， 就是这些，他一定要一直要住在这边双核才可以这样跳，因为我们是要抽血做那个了解他的。
就因为临床试验，所以而且如果他刚到，平均应该会待10天左右，因为你不能马上做。他先要安定，然后医生也要评估，而且也有他们还要照顾的地方。
对，
然后可能因为他们的特色之一就是他们的动作很多，所以好比说最近也某一个病人好像家带他去做 MRI 好像4次，因为你没有办法做完。如果你的头动来动去的话，那个 image， if the head is moving around, the image is a failure. So we have to go back. And then it's a little bit easier with PET because you can kind of put your hand on their head to try to hold it there. But on the average, so when we do the MRI and we do the PET and then the clinical assessment, and also of course it's a clinical trial with the drug, so you give the drug once and you look at their reaction, then you give a placebo in a 双盲的实验, give them the placebo and check their reaction. So it's a rather complicated process, so it takes time. And then some patients they have a reason to believe there's one now in Hsinchu and there's one in Jilong who Taiwan Baolio. Of course, they worry about I Ching, they worry about other things, but there's evidence that their children that they are have periods where they respond. So there's many things before too in the past. I don't like to emphasize Xin Guan Du because it's overused. But I think there are lessons in history which it's 以前错怪西班牙流感. I think actually it came from someplace near my hometown in 美国的中西部 in Kansas. But one of the interesting things about that is that similar to COVID, COVID attacks the brain. In that particular case, there were many young people who they recovered from the influenza virus in the 1920s. Mm-hmm. But then after a couple of years, they fell into a the terms accrued frozen state.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a rather eccentric clinician in the 1960s, so 40 years later, and that was when I guess the first Parkinsonian drug, L-DOPA, was discovered. And so he had patients, and they were just being treated, again, like vegetables in the clinical setting. And then this drug was, synthetic dopamine was invented. He started giving it to them, and they woke up after 40 years. And one of the remarkable things about this to me is that we all lose consciousness, or we seem to, every day. So we sleep. We go into a slow wave pattern of sleep. It's a very deep sleep. But then we wake up the next morning, and just a metaphor, we reboot. Of course, the problem with the patients is that they don't reboot. Or if you go in for a medical examination, you might be given general anesthesia, and you just feel a little bit cold, and then you disappear for 30 minutes, but then you reboot. And the problem with these patients, they don't reboot. But when we do it in the morning, we can reach back very quickly to who I was just a few hours ago. One of the remarkable things in that case, it seems that consciousness, if it's latent there, it has this remarkable capacity to even extend over a 40-year period of time so that they can reach back those patients in that. His name was Oliver Sacks, and they made a rather interesting movie about it. The Chinese title, I think, is called Shui Ren. It's Awakenings. So they're able to reach back from 1965 to 1925 in a way that's similar to how we could reach back, or I reached back at 6:30 this morning to the situation I was in at 12 o'clock at night. But we see little indications, and I don't want to exaggerate this, but there are people who suffer from the coronavirus, from COVID, and they have a period where they're just not responding, they're not rebooting into consciousness. And so this is one of the other, one of many reasons why I think it's important to try to get a handle on what those sufficient or necessary conditions are and what kind of technologies might be helpful in enabling the clinician to give better diagnoses and better prognoses. Did I?
其他想问。不好意思。
我觉得，回到刚刚就是说，如果我们的一个 center 就在北部，
嗯，
第一个其实 only one so one 就是会是困难的，
嗯，
我自己想说，如果你的 center 就一个，又台湾其实虽然距离3000多公里，可是它就是会产生就是一个 so one 的障碍，它就是这样，就是只是对，那只是我现在是想是说，我们今天是不是就是。最主要的是，就是我是有看到信啊，是说希望更多的工具能够 support，因为毕竟这是 study 嘛，
嗯，
这个不是一个就是，其实 study 就跟健保有关了，
对啊，当然，
对，
这个还没有到健保，
对，还不到嘛，就是只是一个 study 而已，那现在可能，就是我不知道是说我们刚刚提到说在个案的部分，其实如果从南到北，其实东到北也是很困难的啦，因为我觉得，还有在离岛嘛，哦，对。
我们目前为止，我们希望就金门有，
金门
有，嗯，
哦，那我是会觉得是说，我不知道你们没有排那个优先顺序啊，
嗯，
就是你们自己方案这个 study 的优先顺序，就是希望怎么样的。其实现在最主要或最重要最急的，
嗯，
其实如果说从科学面，so scientific priority and even to some extent clinical priority, there are certain categories of patients who might be more hopeful. Maybe because I'm too sentimental. Maybe for I hate to articulate 一个非常明确的优先顺序，因为好像是代表有一部分的我愿意放弃。我倾向于不要，不过当然是你任何临床实验，你比如说你未满20岁啊这些了，你必须要有特殊情况才能够参加，还是你超过75岁，等等这些都。不过，我想，当然，临床的医生他们看的最多。And then, from a scientific point of view, so Yan Ting and Neil, they could say, well, we understand that you're sentimental. We understand you would like to try to help everybody, but realistically, the chances are very low. Or the clinician would say, I've seen a lot of patients like this, and I've followed them over a long period of time, and these patients are more hopeful, and these patients are less, or their prognosis is not so good. So in that sense, of course, there is a priority, a 优先顺序, but personally, I try to avoid making that too rigid. So we've had patients over 70, and our youngest patient is Jack. 最年轻是几岁？
最年轻，原本有17岁，但后来是在那个还年纪不到。
对，我还有我们还有我们有几个病人，他们是小朋友，那个是不算临床实验，那是其他的医生就跟他们沟通，就是帮忙评估一下而已。So that's these are the patients who are in the 临床实验. And then these are other patients. There, we've had children and a few children who could not be enrolled in the trial, but that we tried to help assess their condition. So.I'll say something too that I think that Neil and Yan Ting might want to correct me on, maybe, I don't know. But one of the problems we encounter is that people will say, well, it's not a high priority. It's not a high priority because dementia or problems related to, zibi zheng or shi zhi zheng, these areyou have a much larger population, so there's more and more old people like me and fewer young people like them. And so maybe this is not the highest priority. The highest estimate I've heard for Taiwan of unresponsive wakefulness, 植物状态, is 3万多. But that could be 高估. So onepractical issue is how many people are you actually able to help? Now, one of the things that I'm going to say that Yan Ting and Neil might correct me on is, so if you look at things like cerebral blood flow, or if you look at things like the brain's metabolism, you see these things, Yan Ting, tell me if I'm wrong, you see these things declining in dementia too. And...I don't know whether that would apply to GABA, the neurotransmitter that Neil is talking about, but, and I'm simplifying, I emphasize I'm simplifying and I'm speculating. So that in 植物状态, it's 突然, it's abrupt, it's a sudden transition. In dementia, it's a gradual transition. Now,I know it's much more complicated than that, but my suggestion would be that the more we can learn about this, the ability to sustain a conscious state, at the same time we're learning more about what it is that is necessary for people of a certain age to sustain healthy cognitive functioning.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, but again, I don't know, Neil or Yenting, do you think I'm pushing that too far?
Not really. Well, in the specifics maybe, but the principle of if you understand the system, then that understanding is transferable. So us trying to understand how consciousness arises out of the brain, well, that helps you understand how everything that consciousness is related to comes out of the brain. So memory, perception. So certainly in dementia, you start to develop these problems with brain systems that are related to consciousness. Now, the understanding is transferable, I think, potentially.
Mm. 眼睛, 我刚那样子刻画视觉的那个过程, 你觉得我有扭曲还是?
It's a complicated problem. And, I think even dementia, we still not know exactly the mechanism of everything. So, but for vegetative status, it's an extreme. So by observing the extreme, we may know, yeah, like Neil say, 这些东西都是 mutual 可以互相理解这样子。
Yeah. Argue one of the things, and this is just me speaking, this is not representing anyone else, so I paraphrase Kant sometimes when I say you look out into the sky. You know, it's the one of the most marvelous things about existence is that you can see the bright stars shining at night. And now again, my distortion of Kant is that when you look inward, what's the most important and what's the most interesting thing? It's that I'm aware that I exist and I'm aware that I am mortal. I'm aware of these things, and somehow I'm able to, even though that we know that the brain does not directly represent what is out in the world, but I have this sense of my own personal existence. And one of the reasons why I mentioned dementia is that it seems like one of the things that is lost is that sense of who I am, the sense of me, and that is lost, as Yenting says, in an extreme way, in a vegetative state. So that's where I was trying to go with that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. In an applied sense, though, still Knox, I believe, that was the chemical that you're experimenting with.
Mm-hmm.
It is also used in dementia, like sleep disorder, things like that, but not in the same way, right?
The origin of using Stilnox was very innocent. It was a good-hearted clinician who's, because the one of their characteristics is they do go to sleep,
mm-hmm.
and they do wake up, but they have spasticity.
Ah.
And so the patient was having trouble going to sleep, and so the just like in Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
So the medication is usually prescribed for sleep disorders.
Mm-hmm.
And that was exactly the reason, that was the motivation for giving it to the first patient.
Okay.
And the patient within 15 minutes after, I believe it was 5 years, I'd have to check it again,
mm-hmm.
after 5 years woke up, and within 15 minutes woke up in the sense of recovered consciousness,
mm-hmm.
and said hello to his mother. So that's also one of the reasons, because it's that neurotransmitter GABA,
mm-hmm.
GABAergic. That's one of the reasons why we asked Neil to look at that particular chemical activity in the brains of our patients. I should emphasize, though, that internationally, the other places which have tried to use still knots, its success in improving the state of patients is less than 10%.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one drug among many that could be tried. It's the one that we chose.
Mm-hmm.
And there are these individual cases where the effects are dramatic. One of the hopes is that we can identify what type of patient is best suited to being given Stilnox, because clearly it doesn't work with every one of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see.
But Neil, did you want, so does that help with the GABA part, or?
That's unclear, the relationship, but it does help on the point. The point that these treatments, people with disorders of consciousness are very varied. So some people get it because they're in a car accident. Some people get it because they have a heart attack.
Mm-hmm.
And the consequences of those different causes are different to the brain. So when we say that someone has unresponsive wakefulness syndrome, that's a syndrome.
It's them as dementia, actually.
Yeah. So a lot of our research in dementia is identifying these subtypes so that
mm-hmm.
we can properly target treatment towards not just, oh, you've lost your memory. It's like, well, how specifically? It's a gross simplification of dementia, obviously. But it's the same with loss of consciousness. So
mm-hmm.
perhaps Zolpidem works for some people who have a particular etiology or particular retained features in their body. Perhaps it works, and it doesn't work in everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of it. As Tim said, like we're trying to identify features that can then tell clinicians, okay, try this with this patient.
Mm-hmm.
In the case of Zolpidem, it's not no big deal because it's such a cheap and couple of pence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But the principle then applies to much more invasive and much more costly treatments. So people are working on like deep brain stimulation for disorders of consciousness,
mm-hmm.
where you implant electrodes to stimulate. You implant electrodes into the center of the brain that you can then try and activate the brain and bring consciousness back. Now that doesn't cost a couple of pence. That's
mm-hmm.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars to do that. So we need to develop tests to say, if you do it with this person, they will wake up. If you do it with this person, nothing will happen. Because you can't do trial and error with that sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And the successful cases, again, too few, but they've been continuing for 3 years or more. So that they're low cost, they're given the Zolpidem, the Stilnox, in the morning. And that helps to sustain a level of consciousness for 3 or 4 hours. And then they can, and that depends on the individual clinician in North America or Europe. Some of them will give it a second time during the day and then try to give them to a point where they can maintain a level of consciousness for the entirety of the day and then go to sleep at night.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not at that point now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it's
interesting.
你有什么想法？我早一点，Neil想要了解，是不是有一些沟通是学术界的人可以更主动，还是更清楚地表达自己的？你觉得呢？Neil本来就是想，就我们自己，那先检讨我们自己，先反省。 那有一些，比如说产学或其他方面的沟通，是不是我们自己有一些可以更努力的、更加强的层面？你觉得？就使得更多的人注意，还是更多的人愿意去关心我、协助？Just repeating your question about communication. Sorry.
我觉得。 你们团队有这样想，其实就是已经很好了。可是我们也，我也只是先几分钟的了解我们这个团队而已。说真的，那当然我是会觉得说，要把这个 study， 如果要就是我们一定可能有一个期限嘛，好，会有希望怎么样？不管这个 study 的那个，只是我就觉得可能就是说，我刚刚会稍微可能我表达的不是很好，就是说，哎，我们现在是在于说，我们在个案的个案来源，其实如果太多，你们也是有困难嘛，对不对？
可是其实他们这边没有困难，
对，
越多越好。
对，我现在是说你们要，对，我现在是想说，这可能你们自己要先厘清的，就是说你是个案来源是受限，大家不知道，还是说我们现在在个案来源够了，可是我这里面的可能就你们说的工具、财力或人力这个部分是可能还要有困难的。那 这个就可能每一个 stage 是不同的，这个的话可能真的都要向外去多跟产学的那些，因为其实我觉得脑伤就刚刚为什么会问你们的 purpose， 就是那个就是每个县市的脑伤其实不大一样，就是它的发生率啦，那个其实这些有些资料都有，交通部嘛，
对，没错，
对对，这些都有，
最近也在做那个，
对，就是那个不一样，那我觉得这个就是另外一个策略。那如果说是在你们现在已经进来的个案了，这个 center 里面人力、物力、财力的这个问题的话，这可能又是另外一个问题。
是另外一个。
这个可能就是跟人家是用合作啦，还是用什么的？我觉得是可能你们要先看你的问题，还有就是最优先要解决的。我这样说的。
Sure, that's a team question.
Thank you. Yep. Well, just and again, just things that we can do from our side to make it, to communicate more effectively what we're trying to do, and then both the clinical dimensions and the scientific dimensions, and why at least we think it's important, you know, some things along those lines.
We've
可以交流一下，
没钱啊！
我没钱，
没钱做什么？
我要买仪器。
OK。
因为仪器双核的仪器太久了 ，MRI。
OK。
OK。
那不能用别人的 MRI。
对，
太烂。
只能够用双核的是吗？
你是说太大了？
对啊，之类。
其实当然。我们愿意跟任何单位合作，因为科研跟临床实验跟救人，那是不分国家，那是不分单位，不分机构。那我想可能一个很大的问题是，这些机器在医院里面，都很忙。都很忙，那而且病人要送来送去也是有很多其他的问题，所以其实最理想嘛，you know, 东部、南部、中部各都有适合的中心，
就在哪里修就在哪里做，
是没错，但是现实面可能并不是每一个单位都学术界也好，临床界也好，他们各都有其他的负担，就他们可能觉得他们要面对的比较大的问题不是这种病人的，所以一开始想法是有一个专门会处理相关问题的一个单位，那而且病人多就是还离家还离开，他们没有睡眠了。其实应该是说期待完全没有病人，期待台湾的所有的医院 生意很烂，
嗯，
就大家都活得平安健康，
嗯，
但是事实并不是如此，
嗯，
那因为是这样子，因为我们已经知道太多太多这种病人就是被忽略，而且太多这种案子，那就是他无法透过他的身体跟外界沟通，而且刚好结合科学里面的最艰难的问题之一，所以就成立这个中心，那尽量想办法有适合的人员、适合的仪器等等，
嗯，
然后就是可以投入到这个以及相关的研究。那当然，如果任何单位是跟我们联络，他们想要帮忙，
嗯，
还是他们也想要走这条路，能够在台湾的其他的地方或海外的其他的地方，这个也不是某一个国家的问题，
嗯嗯，
那我们当然愿意合作。有一段时间可能因为东南亚台湾有很多国家就有骑摩托车闹伤，所以这些问题可能以前更多更明显的，那个后来有稍微减少，不过根据 交通部的那些资料还是有那个几率，有一些地方几率是蛮高的。
我们正在找哪些地方
So, but, 有一段时间也是资料可能立刻就更有更新的资料，脑伤的，如果病因是脑伤，它的 prognosis 它的机会比较大，但是其实缺氧的也很多，
嗯，
那中风的也很多。目前为止新冠毒虽然会有一段时间它就好像不容易 reboot，
嗯，
不过大部分后来还是 reboot，
嗯，
目前为止是如此的。 So it's a 听起来有点残忍， you know， 不过当然是 有一些人他会去找那个骑摩托车的人多，因为脑伤的机会就比较大。
That's right.
But that's just it's a practical, but it feels uncomfortable to say that.
Feels utilitarian.
It feels utilitarian. But it's a realistic consideration.
Yeah.
It's a realistic consideration.
Right. So MRI 才多少？两千万？三千万？
一亿。
1亿，哦，OK。
MRI 不是可以租的吗？
嗯，目前在台湾有几台 MRI 是科技部补助的。
哦。
分到不同的单位，那就他们不是临床实验为主的。
嗯
嗯。
他们是健康受试者为主，那是十多年以前的科技部的一个计划，他是想要推动那个对可能人文或社会科学相关的议题的研究，因为之前所有的那个我们说三 T MRI 就解析度不够高，所以适合做研究的，都集中在医院，那是可以的，那没有说，有几种贵重仪器，你可以到别的单位借，而且因为是纳税人扛科技部，纳税人扛，所以那个不会太贵。我们面对的问题是，我们的病人是比较不容易用到科技部目前补助的那几台，
嗯嗯嗯
，MRI， the most MRIs, the ones that they fund, it would be very difficult under the current. They are much cheaper, but but it would be very difficult to use one of those machines with our patients. They're not designed for that purpose, and I think there's other limitations on
it. Just, they're not located in the right place. If your patients are in the hospital, you really need to scan them in the hospital. Because
mm-hmm.
GP ones are not in your separate facilities.
使用目的不一样。
是是，当时他们好像后来他们的弹性变得比较大一点点，我的理解，我的认知。但是以前他们的对使用的目的就不一样。对，
嗯，所以这个 T 就解析度是越高越好。
对，
对，
所以
你们的研究就是，好像说在三 T 或者在七 T 做，那就是越后面的越容易得出结果。
我们用的是三 T，那好比说双核以及应该台湾就大部分的规模相当大的医院都最起码有 1.5T 的，所以就临床上验听可以，当然讲得比较清楚。他们很多他们要看的 1.5T 就够用
了，
就够用。But 验听你要
就是 for functional 的研究的话，就是一般讲市场越高，就会讯号就越多，你得到的东西就 越可信这样子。对，那我们像我们在观察的这些 vegetative status 的很大的，我们都是观察它 resting 的 status。那resting status 你要去看出差别的话，那个信号的那个杂讯就要越低越好，才能够看出真的有意义的变化。那在正常人的话，有时候我们会给他一些刺激，让他有些反应，有反应的话，他那个变化就会比较大。那也许那个信号的那个解析度就不用这么细的。那所以就我们的 purpose 来讲的话，需要 functional 的 MRI 的时候，通常都是那个磁场越强，信号越好越好。那事实上，除了磁场强度以外，这个 MRI 的价钱有差别，主要是 MRI 它是一个很精细的那个电磁场的那个的设备，所以它除了主磁场以外，它的那个扣也可以有线圈，受训的线圈给自己的线圈也都会不一样。那所以不同的价位，它那个讯号的那个品质也会有所差距这样子。但这个就是从外面看，你如果说单纯说三 T， 它的那个价差也是可以很大。那跟这些细部的这个设备有关。那对，那这个就是比较是细节的部分这样子。对
OK。
七 T 的话是 ，I think the seven T's now are only used on animals. Is
that? Yeah, that's right. 有小动物什么的，对。
三 T
在阳明北路。
Yeah, 在台湾是在
台湾。
在。
Yeah, there's no 7T human scanner in Taiwan.
It's approved in US and in Europe. Can be scanned in human, and then 那个效果很惊人，亲眼看到，对对对，细的那个脑里面的那个 nucleus 一些小的神经都可以看得到。然后那个脑的那个表层有六层，它这个。你可以看到好几层，那解析度会完全不一样。那这个对于神经的机制的研究会有很大的帮助。因为你看的越细，你就 越能够相信你得到的讯号是从哪里来的。不然的话，你都是有点是那种推测的这样子。对对对。那 CT 是很早以前就有在讲说，希望能够在台湾建立，但是一直还没有。
7T for humans has been very free.About a decade now, probably.
Yeah.
I used to be in my PhD in Germany. That's probably 10 years ago now, which is a depressing thought. But they're expensive.
How much are we talking about?
It's probably, let's say, $7 million.
Okay.
But there's some interesting developments in for the clinical point of view in micro Tesla MRI, where you can actually, it becomes a portable unit that you can take to a patient. the problem with MRIs is they're like they're giant magnets. So if we were sitting next to it, all of our metal would fly towards them and all our credit cards would be waved. Not a bad thing. And they're developing ones that you can take to the patient. And another interesting area is optically pumped magnetometers, which are a different technology, but also allow imaging of brain function. I think there's some work in Taiwan on that. They were invented recently in the UK, and I think there's some people in Taiwan that are starting to work on that. I think that'd be a really interesting area to develop in terms of making it more accessible for patients.
Okay. So Shuanghe has a Santi.
Correct.
Which is like an aged model. So sorry, I was trying to
understand. It's 12 years old. Sure, and any chance your son any chance. It's an old machine.
Mm-hmm.
It's similar to me in that way. I'm an old machine.
It works, but we don't have access to the nicest of the new. Everything that's been developed in the past 10 years is more challenging on the older machines.
It's just a lot of practical problems. So as Yenting just said, so one of the things you look at is the state where if it's a healthy subject, you tell them to just fang kong or just to fa dai, just so a resting state, not sleeping, but resting. And as soon as it gets to that state, it gets very noisy, even more noisy than it normally is. And so many patients we put in there, the first part is okay, but then they enter the resting state and they just start jumping all over the place.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There's many, many practical problems of that sort that cause trouble collecting good data.
Mm-hmm.
And, some of the newer machines reduce that noise problem. So they're engineered to... I don't know if you've been in an MRI. It's not.
I'm compelled to go to MRI every year.
It's not the most pleasant.
That's okay.
If you want to take part in any of our studies, you're very welcome. Always recruiting participants.
Okay.
The newer MRIs, they're engineered so that the noise is hugely reduced, which is obviously a huge advantage when you're working with patients, and particularly with patients who you can't tell it's okay because they're not conscious. So their body naturally responds to this auditory assault by freaking out. So having machines that can do it more silently is a huge advantage. But hopefully,
I've been going annually for the past 5 years to the Yadong Far Eastern Memorial for the MRI scanning. The noise doesn't seem to be so bad. Well, it's noise, it seems sound too bad.
If you're interested, you can come and try the arterial spin labeling in our hospital.
Yeah.
That will be very noisy.
I see.
Because it's a long taking. 电磁波攻击, so it has like a bang, 很大的声音, 很吵, 会把, 放在, 有些病人坐一坐, 躺在那边, 那个, 没事, 然后坐到那一处的时候, 就跳起来, 因为太大声,
就是。 I see. Okay. 所以同样是3D的型号可以差不多。
不同的 sequence 会不一样, 因为它是 MRI的功, 原理是用电磁, 电磁波去打它, 不同的 sequence 会有不同的特色, 那有些 sequence 它电磁波打特别强, 打几秒这样子, 那声音就会特别的明显。
OK, 还有什么 practical 的钱可以解决的事情？还应该，
因为我只想到那一台仪器而已，就希望可以收到好的 data， 这比较要紧。对，那其他的目前就是 如果说是救护车费或哪些都 还可以撑得住，以后撑不住再说。
嗯，
对。但就是有先后顺序的话，我也先是觉得我们的那个影像品质要好一点，因为这样也方便，就是他们可以分析，然后也比较有用。不然就是一个其实讯号不好的话，病人一直等于像做 resting 的时候会做到四次，就是他被吵醒，我就是我会跟技术员就讨论说，大家休息一下，然后再送他下去。
嗯，
可是可能又失败了，就这样来回。
Oh, okay.
对，其实对他们也是折磨。
是，
对，然后但是
你们也很爆肝。
对，
对，
然后 data 也未必是好的。
I see, I see.
对，
嗯 ，OK， 有意思。
我想，最后一个，如果说是仪器的话，我想应该医师你应该很了解。如果说我知道我们台湾的医疗器材还不会算很差啦，只是我是说，像譬如说，如果各大医院中南部啊，像你们个案如果来是其他的，是不是他们只要有脑神经，就是那专科，神内跟神外的，他的仪器是不是就符合你们的？那如果说这可能要你们自己去了解那几个大医院，如果他们有这个专科啊，然后又有这样的病房，那他是不是他就会具备你们所需要的这种 MRI？
就等于是你们类似远距 train 他们的。
对，然后你跟他们做谈合作，虽然说他那个仪器是要用在治疗病人或者不是 study 为主，可是医院他们都每个人都需要做，在评鉴来说，他们都要做相关的这个合作跟研究，
嗯，
那你们跟他们谈，然后用远距的部分这样。我是想就是说，最主要是你们来自那个仪器嘛，
嗯，
是不是可以这样子去试看看？因为像长庚就是一个非常在南部，我说的是高雄长庚，我想医师你应该都知道，他就是在高雄来说算是对这个也是很有研究。只是以我现在，我不知道现在是不是高一还是高雄荣总啊？我是说以前的时候，我知道的时候，啊，中部的话就要是台中荣总吧，还是什么？就是看你们是不是可以，像他们都是教学医院，他需要做另外的 study， 就是他们自己本身医院的就会被定于要做什么做什么。想说你们给你们，
我们有过，还是燕婷你要是先说吗？
都谈过失败了，就是。
就是看说你的定义是在临床的 purpose 还是 research？ 就 research 就有很多细节的要求会不太一样。那目前的规范大概都是对临床的 scan， 对 structural 的 scan， 平常诊断的 scan， 那是有一定的规范要 fulfill。那各大医院应该是都可以做到，但是你到了functional MRI， 例如说像 GABA， 这个全世界就没有太多的 site 是真的可以做得到，那有很多很细致的部分需要去建立，那不只是机器而已，它里面的那个有没有这个 sequence， 有没有这个sequence， 就是
我知道，就是一个它要求比较
多，
研究
的序列，
研究软体，它
对，所以都需要考量在里面，
研究软体还有。确实还有后面，即便你那个 sequence 都一样，而且你用的软体是都一样的，但是
还有很多硬体的部分，你的磁场的均匀度是都需要考虑。那但在临床的要求上，并不会到这么高，那都是像在国外的话，这种 advanced neuroimaging center 都是有一群另外一群。MR physicist
专门
电机系的教授，当，
嗯，
然在维护这个机器，那他们就是对于那一部分东西很，所以我们其实有发现，在我们机器老了以后，它那个在 scan 的过程中会 drifting， 它那个磁场会漂移，那会造成你的讯号会有点不是很稳定。那这个东西就是需要很多的很仔细的去照顾它，才有办法一直维持那个品质。那你不可能要求每一家医院都去有这样的资源去做这些事情，所以。到最后，这些 specialized 的研究性的东西，最后在即使在国外也都是 centralized，到那个地方，它才能够维持的 quality。那当它真的确定这个事情是完全可做了以后， 它再散布到到其他医院，不然的话那个成本会很高。你每个地方都要有一套那样子的机器，像刚刚他说那个机器是等级是不一样的，那可能你对药水他们就是要用到那个机器，但如果你不是那个机器的时候，住在小伙子上就有差别。
所以像我看现在在看那个 Minnesota， 它有一个 CMRR， 它去年九月我就有注意到说什么人看颜色的时候的脑里的状态，它用气体做了一个 open access 的一个 data set， 所以对就这种东西，对，那所以像你说的意思就是说，他们是一堆这个不管是电机或 data science 的人在 curate 这个 center， 那大家是类似像分望远镜的时间那样子，对，就是把 research plan 给他们这样子。那在台湾虽然是有就是贵重仪器的分享，但是比较不是在这个领域比较不是有这种形状的东西。
对，台湾的话就是说学校的那个政大就是台湾的那些研究，他是不让病人做。然后在医院的话就是医院主导了，医院的话就是没有 physics 的人，所以他只要 structure 你这样看他就很满意了。对，
所以就是你们好像是一个就是好像 capstone， 就是去把它衔接起来，
有两边的人可以起做，这个在国外是蛮常见的。
了解，
像比如说到 Stanford 啊，他们有几个主要 hub 会做这些事情，有这个资源去把它推到一个 limit 这样子。
光是给出 signal， 这样看起来也是一个很大的研究题目，就是怎么样把 noise 弄成可以接受的程度这样。
Yeah.
很多 AI 的，是
如果理想的世界，也会有一个我们的 hub， 会有物理学家、电机背景的等等，就很多个 neuroimaging 的 clinicians 的，那数学家等等，AI 专家，但是假设等到时机都成熟了才开始，那我觉得永远都等不到那一天了。所以我就是现有的环境尽量 push， 那然后打一个基础，那看从那个基础能再发展下去。It's an old story. Neil's heard this too many times before. It's about two Irish guys. They walk out of a bar, and they see this very high wall, and it looks very intimidating to climb that high wall. And so the one guy dares the other guy, 看你敢不敢爬. And he takes his hat off and he throws it over the wall. So his 朋友问他你为什么这样子把你的帽子就丢过去. He says, I really like that hat.And so now I have to climb the wall. 我非爬不可。虽然我很害怕，但是我非爬不可。I guess from the beginning, the start was kind of like that. I just decided to throw my hat over the wall and try to get things started. But, I'm very clear, it's exactly as Yenting says, that a hub of the type I envision.That we're quite far away from that hub. We're just doing our best each day to try to find ways to solve problems. So, with the patience and the help of very talented young people. So,
okay.
Okay. 老板很凶是吗？
没有。在这个 center 多久？
一年多。
一年多，觉得怎么样？
就是中心在做有意义，就是帮助很多，就是帮现在虽然还没有很多，可是就是希望未来可以帮助更多人这样。
晚清也是跟亚东有关系。
亚东毕业。
啊，是。
好。
Cool. 有没有想要补充分享或
any other
按赞分享开启小铃铛
我想讲就是说像其实我们想象起来就是我们收案其实会非常多的来源，因为有意识问题的病患或是说各种不管是以前一路到现在其实是很大量，那我们之前有跟像创世基会有讨论过，但是其实他们已经到照顾的阶段，很多时候其实已经被安置，然后其实也不会再有想要再做任何探讨或是说改变的动力，对，所以其实我们急性期有急性期的事情，然后到了长照的话又有长照 的安排，所以其实我们收案没有那么不是那么容易，就是譬如说我们在医院中其实也不太能够去干扰别人在主要治疗上的安排，所以其实是希望能够有一些更多连结，就是说如果有，因为很多人会去家属或是他们会彼此认识会问说有没有可以评估或是有没有进一步治疗，他们其实有很多的比如说偏方或是说到处询问，对，那我们可能也是其中一个可以他们可以去就是说如果想要知道这方面有一些更多讯息，虽然我们没有特别治疗，但是可能有一些更多评估这样子。
嗯，所以像创世基金会他们是会帮你去 assess 就是适合或者有意愿的人，还是只是说给你们一个类似名单你们可以去联络？
这个他们因为比较偏长照，那其实就是要跟他们有一个入窗口、然后就你跟他联系，然后他就会说我每个月帮你宣导一下这样，可是他并不会鼓励我们说就是说我们到那边去找病人，或者是他们其实主动介绍病人给我们，其实不会，所以对于我们中心的研究计划，对他们来讲，他们可能就只是宣导，但不会，你就不会把这件事放在心上啦。因为其实创世基金会的走向是就像那个立凯医师讲，是长照跟就是安置，他并不会希望我们就是对他们来讲，他们也不会希望说多一个就可能负担嘛，就是说第一还要就是主动询问，
至少时间上的负担，
对，然后还有说。也要帮我们注意有哪一些条件我们才可以收案，那他们也就对啊，就是负担，那我们也不肯期望他那么做，那如果我们自己主动去，他们也不是说太欢迎，因为毕竟每个病人有各自，
所以因为创世的宣导而来找你们，有给这个 referral code 的有人吗？
有啊，还是有，就是可能就是每个月逼一下，然后他们会想办法伸出一两个，
了解，所以就是一个月有一两个，
对，就推荐了一下，然后通常如果请他们宣导，他们就说报告上级，然后就是要打电话烦他们一下，对，但是他们不会以我就是以这一类，我们也对，但也可以理解啦，因为他们其实很多病人要照顾，这样，对，所以创世那一边的情况会是比较这样
，OK，
他们的任务不同，
对。
是
像那个立凯医师，他有跟那个，因为每个医院都现在都被规定，连健保给付也规定要做 discharge planning。那如果他们都有一个这个 center， 每个医院，尤其这两年，因为长照退之后就 push，因为确实返家的人会经过那里，看你们要不要接触一下各大医院有省内的这些的。或省外的有 discharge planning，
就是说把它放在出院准备服务的横线，
对
的那一
告诉他们，请他们，当然他 discharge planning 他会连很多资源，要日据的，要去那个，譬如说要去安置的，要去 nursing home， 可是你就告诉他，可是必须就是就是这个不可能一次啊，你就是要一直有这个 contract，一直跟他们谈，然后呢就是或者找他们来，全部把这些都找来。
对，
就说还有一个这个，
因为刚刚听起来两边就是在最忙的时候急症的时候跟已经完全安置了，两边各有各自的priority， 那跟你们 priority 是不能说 orthogonal， 但是差的角度有一点大，对，那但是刚刚美琪讲的是说，但是在这个 transition 的时候会有个夹角刚好比较近的一个地方，
看要不要试看看，因为每个医院它都现在评鉴它就是一定要做， 然后现在又加上健保给付，虽然是说 我知道我们现在各大医院就是比较 level 高的已经有300多家都进来，你可以再试看看，就比较是属于你们要的。
我们最近也在讨论，就因为我们在譬如说去社区做一些那个就是居家探访，也会看到刚从医院出来大概就是类似那个状态，所以有考虑要先从北医双和这些体系开始先联系转社区的这个部分。
对对对对，那 discharge planning 他们现在很多医疗的医院呢都是归在护理部，因为他是用就是那个 nursing 就是用 nurse 来当他的主角，那或者是他的那个nursing home 有附设 nursing home 啊，或者是那个，或者是反正就是最主要都还是护理部为主导，对，那就请他们协助，或者是相关病房那个护理长，这样子，看有没有对你们没有宣导的帮助。
哎，这个是他们来申请吗？那个出院准备衔接？
对，先有两个花花，一个是长照的给付的钱，一个是健保，健保是给点数。
I see。
那这个呢其实
已经脱离失败了嘛，这个是一个一般性的计划了。
对，可是他们现在就是说就是逐渐脱离之后让他们就是 fit 就是要跟长照连在一起了，那所以前面呢都还是有一些 suppose， 就是他会现在是变得是后他已经都成立了，可是用后面的支付来
cover 前面的，
对对，然后让他这组织成立起来
啊。 OK， 了解了解。 okay，
对，有阶段性的。
对，那这样子确实就是如果前面的护理的那边知道有这件事情的话，那他等于已知费用后面可以 cover，
对，
他就比较敢去建议。
对，因为他们有现在就是从医院要连到长照，那就有这个桥梁，就是 discharge planning。 可是不是很多的医，因为我觉得这个连到长照这边比较是属于你们的族群，可是如果他是连到那一种就是 discharge planning， 你不会就只有长照的需要，还有一些其他的嘛，他可能只是财务的需求，那就不会连到这边的，或者很简单他只是一个辅具的需要，或许他不会连到这边的。可是这是一个桥梁，你可以试看看。那我知道是健保他的他也有连到他的那个复健，现在我们要做复健医院，这个也会是你们的族群。那这些呢它的对象医院在健保网上都有，你们可以去查哪些医院。
可是他们还是研究计划，他们 qualify 赋能服务吗？对对，
现在就是他的赋能一定就是可以，就是应该是说你们在研究，我现在就是
会变成说他们的中心只是 evaluate，
对，
是不是能够 qualify 赋能服务会变这样。
就看你们收案的对象，你们的要求那个条件，因为他如果可以衔接到长照去赋能的话，他一定还会继续走，因为他还是希望有机会嘛，恢复。可是就是这有没有影响到你们刚刚说你那个研究的那个那个标准啊，或者什么什么什么的，还是你们就单纯只有比如说吃你们的好，然后都不能动还是什么？因为这我就比较不了解，就是这个收案评估可能要你们要去
对
去。
就是说我们现在的这个思路是让就是它的 social impact 变成不能忽视。对，那一旦有不能忽视的 social impact， 那你要动员就是后面这边的能量才比较多。对，就是有点像是就是Tim 本来在讲的类似 dementia 在 research 那边。那但是那边的问题当然是说大部分找失智症的资源的这个绝对不会是第一个在 Google 第一页找到的东西。
没错，没错。
对，那我们要来谈 SEO 也是可以。但是就是说另外一个方法是说那让它变成至少他评估了然后觉得不适合，或但是他至少 aware of it， right？ 就是他知道有这件事情存在，这样子。
这是在医院端。如果他回到社区的话，你就找各县市的长照中心，每个县市都有，那个也是一个，他已经回到漏接的，有回到家里的，那他们都会去评估，然后这些人你们也可以，这些的窗口都有，你们也可以找他们。
大概就是出院后可能到6个月左右 的这个 window 了，
对，
就 maximize 这个 window 的 exposure。
就看，
感觉上是一个可能性。
要不要踹看看？
谢谢，
没有，
谢谢。
那如果跟长照他们，就是说要让他们有就是注意到这件事情，
嗯，
那一定要对他们有一些诱因吧？
对啊，当然可能好起来就是诱因。
对啊，还有就是你们的，嗯，要你们的个案的那个标准哈，
嗯，
就是很简单啊，
嗯，
比如说你做一个 checklist 的五项，让他勾勾勾。
嗯，
然后就直接 pass 给你，
嗯，
就是你们要做的
一个评估量表，
对，你们要很简单，哎，告诉他啊，之后再你们再筛嘛，
嗯，
哎，那当然我是觉得转给你们之后，最好是你们不管有没有收，一定要 feedback 给人家，
嗯，
哎，这个可能才会良性的，
当然，
嗯，哎，这样会比较好，因为他们很多人找他们转，转一转之后都，不知道到哪里了，
嗯，
结果怎么样，哎，
嗯，
这样子，或者是你们找几个县市，像说北部嘛，好，先几个。北部的那个长照中心，
嗯，
北部长照中心都在卫生局，有的县市在社会局，有在卫生局，就找卫生局，
嗯，
都可以。
您自己所接触过的，
嗯，
您有没有觉得哪些长照中心是经营的比较好？因为我看非常多，嗯，
你说那个。说的是长照机构，是指的是那个 resident 二十四小时住在里面那一种的吗？
嗯，
因为我们长照机构有分三种，一种是在家里，一种是 daycare 的，一种是二十四小时的。
对，
你先说的是二十四小时。
一般我们接触的，如果是在家里照顾，那些病人的情况是非常好的。
对，
我不是说他们有机会有好转的，
嗯，
但是因为
对他
很用心照顾，
嗯，
但是如果是在外面二十四个小时，
嗯
嗯，问题比较多，
嗯，
问题在那边，所以 我问的是后者那个，
哦，
那有没有一些你根据你的经验觉得经营的比较，
其实应该是说，嗯，这种的哈。经营的好不好，我觉得如果说用客观的讲的话，你就先看评鉴表，评鉴的 label， 它评鉴的等级。那刚您提到的那一种的机构呢，有分养护机构、护理之家跟长照机构，
嗯，
很抱歉，台湾吼政府做定的法令吼那个名字太多，让民众都搞不清楚。
新北市护理之家非常多。
对，那这三种呢，现在呢都是要由中央来做评鉴，那你就看社家署还有卫生福利部，他有公告，还有长照司他有公告那个标准，你可以去先去找那个优等的，
嗯，
先去就是先去找这些的。那我觉得如果说乙等还好，可是丙等一下其实就不好了。
是说我看到的，我不好意思我讲的比较白，
嗯，
我希望你不介意，我看到的我比较会令我担忧，这个是，就是那些不是优的，
哦，
那就，因为最担心的是某一些病人是有机会，
嗯，
但是就是因为等于是被放弃，
嗯，
也不是说任何人故意的，就是 ，so it's，
其实
我知道我刚问的是我问的也是模棱两可，
嗯，
说经营的比较好呢，
嗯，我了解，其实我们。说真的，我以前有管过这些，我们了解。可是有时候说真的，因为照顾这个是一个长期的负荷，有时候家属没办法，就是要送去那里。
对，
然后照顾的机构反而有时候家属我们都知道不好，
很现实，大部分都是家境比较好的，他可以好好的在家里，
对，
也有一些协助，那可能也是二十四个小时的那个看护或之类的，但往往就是变成家境的问题的。
对，因为你看，我曾经坐过一台计程车，我赶着去一个地方，好像也是去双河那时候，然后呢，哦，就听我在讲电话，然后他说，哎，你是老师？我说我不是。然后他说，我就说他问我做什么？我说我公务人员。然后他说，哎，你做什么？你刚刚一直在讲的。我说，哦，我是在做那个长照。他就跟我讲说。哦，那个司机他跟我讲很久，我才知道他每天要开计程车，要多开两三个小时，他一个月要付他妈妈22000的养护机构费用，
嗯，
是没办法，所以他只能送这里。
嗯，
I know.
确实就
我相信你完全了解我的意思，
因为他跟我讲很多长照，我说你怎么那么懂，哦，原来他跟我，原来他是家里面有这个，所以我非常的能够感同身受。嗯，对，
谢谢你，谢谢，
希望有帮助。
嗯，有，一定有，一定有。
我们还有十分钟，看大家还有什么想要聊什么。OK，
有没有别的你要问我们的？还是 Would you like to ask us anything or anything that we can help you with?
Well, so maybe just for the record, 我们今天这个对谈我会先放到 YouTube 上面，然后是 unlisted。那大家可以回去就是快速再看一下，如果说觉得几分几秒要怎么样的话也可以跟我们讲，我们讲的当然都可以公开，都没有问题。那然后如果大家都 OK 的话，我们就会转成 public， 那我们会用 Creative Commons Attribution License， 就是说只要有付出处，那就包含商业的利用，包含做任何广告运用，什么都可以。那就是大家如果在房间有看到，有时候有人拿我的头像去推荐特定产品，那都是没有问过我的，就是因为知道我不会告他们。那因为我们是 Creative Commons 嘛，所以像日本也有拿我们的访谈去 remix 做成那个饶舌 hip hop 之类，所以也许这个我们的对谈也会被做成 hip hop， you never know， right？ 所以在这个情况下，我们的目的当然是最大化这个概念的扩散。
嗯，
对，那不管是在刚才美琪所建议的，就是刚出院后的六个月，或者是刚才大家所建议的，比较像是在研究圈子里面，大家知道说本来在做的研究跟你们做研究其实有意想不到的重叠，那或者是也许从科技部的角度来看，他未来要投资真的非常好的 MRI 的时候，那说不定可以多想一想这个 Hub 的方向等等，那这个就不会限定它的扩散方向这样子，所以就很欢迎就是揭露啊或怎么样都非常欢迎使用这样子。
了解，
嗯，
了解都，那我想
还有时间了，
哦，对啊还有时间，
那我可以工商时间，
工商时间来请。
对，就是我觉得我们的就是医生啊，还有科学家，就是他们真的很厉害很好，就是一方面还没扩散到中南部，是因为像我扫描一个人的话，我就要直接跟 Neil video call， 就是他要帮我看那个 location， 就会吵他，但他人都很好，然后有问题问燕婷他也都会回答，然后立凯就不用说了，他就很可怜，就是我24小时可能就都他 line 给我应该是最后悔的事吧。对，然后Tim 就被我吵，他就算了，因为我老板，就他们都很好，
就是被你吵是应该的。
对对对对对，就是这个就义务性的。对，然后真的就是我们就是我们团队的人都蛮，就是有考量到实际面，也真的有想要帮助到人。对，但是我们也知道这件事很难做，所以就是还是尽力去做。那现在就是走一步是一步，然后就是能帮多少就帮多少。
但是你刚刚说就是扩散到南部，
中南部，
中南部，你觉得
团队上就
主要的阻碍会是？
以我来说好了，就像我在带病人去扫 3TMRI 的时候，我对技术员，我就只可能我真的就会只比较相信我们双和医院的有一位叫燕杰的技术员，对，然后在问问题的时候，我也会问燕婷、Neil 或者是丽卡，就是我会有，因为我相信他们。可是如果虽然放到中南部可以说是做远距，可是我不相信他的技术真的是否会达到那样的
了解
的那个，这也是我会比较担忧的那一块，所以我才会觉得那我如果是中南部，我宁可想办法多花一些钱坐救护车把它弄上来。
了解，
这样
了解，
就是因为我觉得病人如果因为我们技术层面的疏失要多受几次苦，其实我不太喜欢这样。对，就那一次成功的事情就一次。好，工商时间。
对，我们在看信的时候，其实也有在想说， 为什么就是那么偏重救护车这件事情、嗯、因为可能因为我们推远距医疗推太久了、嗯、所以就是很自然的会想说、嗯、那为什么不是你远距去 mentor 在地的团队等等，对，那但是这样子你讲其实是关乎就是因为这毕竟是有研究成分，所以是关乎跨领域的信任的问题，
对，
嗯，
是
OK， 了解。
其实欧美的类似的 hub 也不算多，
嗯，对啊，
it's just 几个地方，可能一方面是这类的病人，如果你要投入到相关的研究，嗯、就是受案是一个很困难的，不是说病人不多，但是因为有各种各样的情况，而使得他们没有办法参加这个相关的研究，
嗯，
所以受案可能也花很多时间。而且人力资源其他方面的资源也是庞大、
嗯、
你有 did you wanna leave us with any final thoughts or
I've got no wisdom to impart.
Okay. Okay, you just invited me, right? Like if you
had... sure.
Sure. But I mean as a you know,probably still responsive person. What kind of study can I actually enroll in?
Amongst the group, we do all sorts of studies with healthy participants.
Uh-huh.
Just doing basic science. So
uh-huh.
At the moment, I'm, for example, doing a study on imagination. So visual imagination and the kind of ranges of visual imagination.Population and how the brain produces mental pictures or doesn't produce mental pictures,
mm-hmm.
as is the case for some people.
Okay.
That's one example. One of my colleagues is doing research on how our sense of self is supported by the brain as well. So that's another thing where we just get people to come in, and that's an EEG study and.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do a task that tries to probe this, and then our self processes.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's always something to do.
Okay. So maybe I go into your machine and it shows my moments of egolessness, feeling no sense of self.
That would be a fun thing to do,
uh-huh.
but there's some legal barriers to how we can do that. There's a lot of cool research on that in the UK and Switzerland
mm-hmm.
at the moment. So using particular pharmaceuticals in order to produce ego dissolution
mm-hmm.
and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But
I was referring to meditation, but
Neil
non-pharmaceutical.
Neil started out in pharmacology.
So I'm a pharmacologist. So
okay, okay. The shortcuts getting there, I see.
More tightly controlled. I mean, one of my colleagues does do research on meditation and sleep. So he's been doing some work for a number of years, and now we're looking at meditation and trying to link that to things like anxiety, creativity.
And what's the data policy? I mean, say I participate.Is there a way for me to say I, for the next 90 years or something, dedicate this data for the open access community?
So I personally make my data open access.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like all researchers to do the same where possible. So yeah, people
mm-hmm.
that participate in my experiments,
mm-hmm.
they give their consent that their data will be made openly available to anyone in the world to use to do...
Perpetually.
Yeah, to do other research on using that data.
It's a very good point too, because when I began, this is one of the things that I forgot about.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get the IRB approval, so you need the healthy subject or the patient's approval to allow the data to be treated in that way. So...That was one of my failings and one of the ways in which they've improved the situation. So, but I think that's the direction I think should go in.
Right. So, but in the non-responsive patient's case, it would be their family giving the approval?
Correct.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Their legal guardian or their
mm-hmm. their legal guardians. Until, of course, they wake up and say otherwise.
But it also gets into a... Let's just take the case that we have right now. So the again, this gentleman with severe frontal damage, mm-hmm. assuming that he's actually communicating with these fingers, so then you get to that borderline. So at this point, so let's say we want to take him back into the MRI scanner mm-hmm. to find out more about what's going on. Should mm-hmm. we ask his legal guardian or should we ask him?
That's right. Or maybe both, just to be safe.
To be safe.
Uh-huh. Okay. It's a very interesting scenario.
Audrey, thank you. You've been very kind and generous mm-hmm. with your time. Thank you too,
sure.
Meiji. Thank you. That's very nice.
Thank you. 谢谢。谢谢大家。谢谢。谢谢。